Hello everyone, it's Micah. Welcome to our Wednesday reaction series where we are going through each of the number one hits of the 1980s. We are now in February and March of 1982, and the number one song for 6 weeks during that time frame was Centerfold by the Geils band. I thought I had this all prepped and ready to go, and now I can't remember whether how you pronounce the G. The Geils band. Okay. Maybe I'll overdub this if I got that wrong, but I'm just not going to say the name of the group again. I do know that Peter Wolf was the lead singer, and he had a solo career where he had some visibility and had some chart success. And that was right in the sweet spot of when I started listening to music in the mid to late 80s. And I know that this group, whose name I will not say until I've confirmed the pronunciation 100%. Geils. I think I just heard someone say it in my head and from memory, so I'm pretty sure that's right. and I know that this was their tentpole single, and they had some other one or two really, really big songs, but they were huge in the early 80s, I know. And I'm very familiar with this song. We're getting into 1982. At this point, these are songs that maybe I didn't hear exactly when they came out, but even if I didn't, I started listening to music, popular music regularly in 1983. So these were songs that were kind of in medium rotation, that would pop up on MTV because they were only about a year old. So they weren't really retro yet, and they were still in some type of rotation. So we're definitely getting into the part of the 80s where I am very familiar with these records. So this will be a revisiting for me. I know that it's a fun, bright rock and roll record, and similar to a lot of songs we've heard recently, it's a little bit horny. There were apparently a lot of people who wanted to talk about sex on record, and I think we're going to see this die down a little bit in the coming years, because I know this is unfortunately also the dawning of public visibility of the AIDS epidemic, and people who already were uncomfortable with sexuality being so upfront and talked about so openly found a perfect excuse to tamp that back down in the mid 80s. So I know that the top of the charts will become a little more calm and a little more romantic as opposed to sexual as we go along. Let's revel in the songs like Centerfold while we can. Let's just go ahead and get into the record.
Was pure like snowflakes, no one could ever stain the memory.
Yes, indeed. I'm not sure if I ever really paid attention to the video that closely, but I don't feel like I missed out on much. I've seen the video before, but I don't think I've like stared intently at it and tried to make any particular sense of it. But like I said, it's not a dense video from a visual perspective. It's just a lot of the same stuff, same imagery repeated over and over. Focusing on the music video, I found that it was a perfect complement to the song. It's a very well executed video for this time frame. We've seen some other pretty cringy videos from an editing and a special effects standpoint. Everything that's done here is done well. There's not, I mean, you can tell, from the age of it that maybe the film quality, which may have more to do with just it not being well preserved than in the inherent quality of the original video. That's maybe not perfect, but the cinematography, the slow motion is not overly cheesy. The cinematography is perfectly professional and adequate for what they're doing here. I just think it's a very competent video and it captures the mood of the song perfectly. It's set in a classroom and in a school, and he's going back. Peter Wolf is in the band, but this is very much focused on the singer. Like, there's a great backing track here. This is a really funky, sinewy, pop rock and roll kind of track. The almost carnival sounding, and I don't know if that's a key. I guess that's a keyboard that opens up the song, but it sounds like a carnival tune or something on a carousel. It's very festive and very bright, and basically the song is about the narrator being blown away by seeing his high school sweetheart in a Playboy or similar type of publication. I didn't want to use a specific term for it because I didn't want to like pigeonhole it or betray any of my personal biases, but it's a type of publication that would have a centerfold in it. I did notice in the lyrics that he talks about the negligee that she's wearing in the photo spread, and I guess the implication is that's what she was wearing in the centerfold photo, which is a bit of a concession. I feel like almost everyone at this point understood that centerfolds were most of the time naked. But I guess they didn't want to evoke that imagery. I don't know. I'm not sure if that was some sort of a concession to trying to be a little bit more modest within the song. Not really sure. But I think the video captured the essence of the song perfectly. And Peter Wolf is a great salesman for the song. He's a great salesman for all of the songs that I've seen him sing of his own and of everybody else. He has an infectious, goofy dancing style that is unique to him, and he never shies away from boogieing down in his videos with his free form choreography, and it's on display here. And in later videos, I think he was a little more self-conscious about it. I do remember the later solo video he had for Come As You Are, where really the focus of the video is following him around as he dances in a really distinctive, goofy way, the way he dances through an entire cityscape, interacting with different people. And it was a good video too, but I think here it was more so, it was there and everybody knew about his performance style, but it was a little less like look at him dance and look at him go. There was one close up of his feet. I don't know if he was considered to be a good dancer at the time or if it was just that his energy was infectious and therefore they liked to focus on that. Either way, it is a great energy he brings to the song. And his vocals are similarly situated. They're very, very bright and very with very humorous intonations. He's definitely not just singing a song or a series of notes, or even really concerned so much with the musicianship of his singing. It's very much more about the attitude he's conveying. And you could kind of say the same for the whole record. I don't think, from what I can tell, and I'm not a musician, I don't feel like there's a lot of sterling musicianship going on here. I think really this is about how well constructed the various hooks of the song are. The pre-chorus, where it gets kind of dramatic and slows down a bit, is probably my favorite part of the song. It's almost, even though the song is very playful, it, for that moment that it calms down and gets kind of dramatic in the pre-chorus, it's almost like it's a beautiful transition. I enjoyed the way that sounded a lot. I did find myself comparing this, as I do, as my habit is, to other songs of the era or in adjacent eras. Recently, I reacted to My Sharona, which was the top song of 1979. So that was, 3 years before this. But I do see some similarities here where basically a song that could come across as a little creepy is brightened up by the jovialness and the hookiness of the song. And more immediately, the preceding number one that we reacted to last week, which is Hall & Oates' I Can't Go For That, No Can Do, similar to that song, this song appears to be a series of hooks just as much as it is a verse chorus kind of song. The verse is so catchy, and the pre-chorus is a little less catchy but more dramatic, but definitely the verse and the chorus are so catchy on their own that it almost reads like a series of hooks one after the other. On top of that guitar lick and on top of that keyboard line, I'm calling it a keyboard line, with the sort of carnival sound, the da-na-na-na-na-na, and then of course them chanting the same melody as the sort of the coda to the song, it's like basically maybe at least three hooks stacked on top of each other with this really nice beat. It's just a very bright, festive record, and it really brightens up the lyrical content, which could be seen as maybe, like I said, just a little bit creepy. Just a little bit. Now, My Sharona, total creep city there, but here it's just sort of hints of, like, the whole idea of a guy singing about a girl in a magazine is, I don't know. I don't think that creepy is really the right word for it, but it's something. It's something, and it can go wrong very quickly, or it can be misinterpreted. Here, I feel like Peter Wolf's joviality and his snark and his personality keeps the song very tasteful, when it could have veered off, even though he makes the one reference to going to a motel and taking her clothes back off after, like, almost insisting that she, like, he wants to see her with the clothes back on. So for a second it sounds like he's being a gentleman, and then he kind of dashes that by saying that he wants to take her to a motel. Even that little piece, which is a bit more raw and raunchy, goes down pretty easy because the overall tone of the song is what it is. All in all, this is just a really enjoyable listen, and certainly a blast from the past for me. So I like that a lot. Definitely understand why it was a 6 week number one. Very much in the spirit of a lot of the other pop rock records of that era, and one of the reasons why people love 80s music. Next Wednesday we will be back with the next number one single of 1982. I hope you'll join me. In the meantime, if you did like this video, please hit the like button. Please subscribe to the channel if you feel so inclined, and please make music.